shining brightly. There is a special spirit in the air.
And crowd together as one people to be God's promised Messiah, rode into the capital of their nation.
They hoped he would free them from the power of the Roman invaders who had ruled their nation.
However, when God's Son rode into Jerusalem, his mission was to free them from sin and the power of death, to bring hope and forgiveness.
Jesus continues to ride and offer his message of hope. He seeks to ride through our streets, to travel our roads, to enter and be a part of our lives.
Those at Jerusalem cried, Hosanna and welcome. May we also welcome the King of Kings.
And will you stand and join in our hymn, singing the first, third, and fifth verses? Kind of a surprise, I suspect, most certainly was to me. Are there other announcements, hopes, joys, and concerns?
All right, you all know Bud was burned last Monday, very, very bad. And he was able to go home to his daughter and break in so she could dress his heart and ran. He was in the hospital and burned his head all Tuesday to see how much surgery he has today. Appreciate all the cares and concerns and the work you provide when I was sick too. It's very important to get us to home this time because I wasn't sick very long.
Thank you. Wrong way.
No, this way.
Well, what happened on this day long ago? And we call it Palm Sunday, don't we? And did you have fun bringing those in?
No.
Sunday, drop the church no matter what. Well, what else happened with Jesus riding in? Was it just palms that they put down on the road? What else happened? Anybody remember that story? Some of them, yes.
He rode on a donkey.
He rode on a donkey, and some people took off what we would call a cloak, kind of like a coat in some ways. Will you join in our hymn, number 277, one that invites us to think of some of the stories that we have recounted in the Scriptures on the hymn.
Thank you.
Cheer up. Get up. He is calling you. So he threw off his cloak and he jumped up and he came to Jesus. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked him. Teacher, the blind man answered, I want to see again. Go, Jesus said, your faith has made you well. And at once he was able to see and he followed Jesus on the road. And as they approached Jerusalem, near the town of Bethany, they came to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus sent two of his disciples on ahead with these instructions. Go to the village there ahead of you. And as soon as you get there, you will find the colt tied up that has never ridden. Untie it and bring it here. And if someone asks you why you are doing that, tell him that the master needs it, and he will send it back at once. So they went and found the colt out in the street, tied to the door of the house. And as they were untying it, some of the bystanders asked him, what are you doing untying that colt? And they answered just as Jesus told them. And the men let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus. They threw their cloaks over the animal, and Jesus got on. And many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches in the field and spread them on the road. And the people who were in front and those who followed behind began to shout, praise God. God bless him who comes in the name of the Lord. God bless the coming kingdom of King David, our father. Praise be, Hosanna. And Jesus entered the temple, entered Jerusalem, and went into the temple. And also, these verses from Paul's letter to the church at Corinth. For Christ's sake, we are fools, but you are wise in union with Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. We are despised, but you are honored. To this very moment, we go hungry and thirsty. We are clothed in rags. We are beaten. We wander from place to place. We wear ourselves out with hard work. When we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure. When we are insulted, we answer back with kind words. I once heard about a trucker who was carrying cars, and he had a full load. In fact, one of those cars was even parked up over the cab of the truck. He was on a little two-lane road that didn't have a lot of traffic. In fact, he hadn't met any cars for quite some time. It was getting a bit late, and he had a deadline. And just before it got dark, he turned on his lights, and they all shined brightly except for one, the headlights. They didn't work. He tried to switch several times. That didn't help. He got out. He looked, trying to find a loose wire. He did everything he could to get his lights on. Nothing worked. And then he had an idea. Out on that lonely road, it really wouldn't make a whole lot of difference how he happened to be able to see the road ahead of him. So he climbed up on his rig, out to that car that was stationed over the hood of the truck, over the cab of the truck, and he turned his headlights on. Got back in his truck, and he was amazed how well that lighted the road ahead of him. Off he went. It was quite a few miles before he had another vehicle, and by that time it was completely dark. You know what it's like. You really can't see anything but the lights of that approaching vehicle. And just before he got to that car, it suddenly swerved to the right. It went out through the ditch and nearly rolled over and continued out into the field in a great cloud of dust. The trucker stopped as quickly as he could, and he ran out to that car thinking the driver maybe had some kind of a medical emergency or maybe some mechanical fault. And as he got there, the driver of the car was just climbing out. And the trucker said, well, what happened? And the other driver said, well, when I got close to you, And I saw how high your headlights were. They looked like they were two stories high. And I suddenly thought, if that thing is as wide as it is tall, it'll run me right over. Sometimes our logic is really foolishness. And sometimes foolishness is really the best wisdom of all. And as we look at this story of Jesus, we would have to conclude that if Jesus was really being politically wise, he would not enter Jerusalem. He would stay away. That was a place of great danger for him. And if he had to go, then he should slip into the city, probably in the dark of night. And if he did so, he should stay out of sight. He should avoid places like the temple where it would be obvious that he was in the city. But that's not what happened, is it? He rode into the city on a colt. The prophet Zechariah, centuries before, had written that when your new king, when your Messiah even comes, you're riding on a colt into the city. Jesus was proclaiming in that way, silently, that he was that one. He had forbidden his disciples to say anything about that before, and now in his ride, he is making it clear. And not only that, when he arrives in the city, he's in the temple. He's driving out those who make a business of defrauding those who come to worship. He teaches there day after day. We would look at that with fresh eyes and would have to say, that's foolish for somebody who wants to stay safe. That's foolish for one who wants to stay alive. We have a day, don't we, for foolishness? For fools? April Fools. And somehow it seems most appropriate that this year, April Fools and Palm Sunday are one and the same. Because if one looks at those actions of Christ, to us sometimes they look like they're foolish. Unless Christ would be foolish for us. In your mind's eye for a little bit, would you look at that vision of him riding into the city? Jesus has joined with his disciples as they walk along towards Jerusalem. They, like other hundreds and tens of thousands of other pilgrims, are going to Jerusalem for Passover, the grandest celebration of their faith. And as they travel along, a crowd collects around them as all of those pilgrims stream towards the city. And they walk along, they talk, and they visit. And those who are close enough to Jesus are excited not only about going to Jerusalem for those high holy days, they're excited that they can hear and see the man they've heard about. And they pass through Jericho, the last city before one comes to Jerusalem, about 15 miles in the distance. And as they're on the outskirts of that city of Jericho, in contrast to the happy throngs that are headed to Jerusalem for that celebration, in contrast to that, beside the road, there's a blind beggar. He's not going. He's an outcast. He sits there every day. The dust that travelers kick up settles on him as life passes him by. Bartimaeus, who can say how long, how many years he's been there? But he is there now, and there doesn't appear to be any hope in his future at all. But something happens. There's an unusually noisy crowd of excited pilgrims, and he asks, what's going on? And someone says, well, it's Jesus of Nazareth who's passing by. He's heard the rumors. He's heard the stories of this one who has wondrous words, who heals the sick, restores sight to the blind, gives hearing back to the deaf. And he cries out, Son of David, have mercy on me. There have been many others who have said things like that through the years, have come up against something in their life, some problem, or simply a life that seems to be wasted, and have finally turned and said, Jesus, have mercy on me. And no matter what their need, they have found an answer of some kind. Well, the crowd's logical. The crowd knows that it's far more important that they, as many as they are, continue on and forget about this beggar beside the road. But foolishness once again enters in. And Jesus stops the procession for one blind beggar. He knows the need of that one man. And for those short times, his need is more important than all of the crowd put together. And so it stops. There is a story from history a few centuries ago about a queen who was going about a queen's business, taking care of some of the business of her nation. And as she traveled along in her coach, they came upon a child crying unconsolably beside the road. And the queen ordered her carriage to be stopped. And she consoled the child as Jesus, in the same way, stopped that procession headed for Jerusalem. Stopped the procession of those happy celebrators. Stopped the procession in which he knew he was going to the city. A city where he would change all of history. Think a bit more about that man. He somehow sensed that this was his one chance of getting back his wife. He could not know that Jesus would never pass this way again. This is, in Mark at least, the last story of him. In a few days, this one who's passing by will be put on trial and then on the cross. So Bartimaeus somehow senses that this is a crossroads in his life. Most of us here have come to crossroad or two. If somehow you have managed not to do that, you can be sure it will come. Because a crossroad comes to everyone. Some are large, some are smaller. Some meet a crossroads the kind that there's something out there you know you shouldn't do, but you're not quite sure if you will or not. And somehow, most of the time, we don't realize that if we do follow that way, it usually leads down a long road, downhill, a slippery slope, as the saying goes. And, one of the more famous things in our society is drugs. And as someone says, no one ever starts out to be an addict. But that's the way it all ends up. And others come to a crossroad in their lives in which if they take one fork in that road, it will lift their lives and the lives of a great many others. The crossroad for Bartimaeus was to continue to cry out, have mercy on me, and not be quiet. One of the most famous crossroads in history is from 49 B.C., a guy named Julius Caesar. He was a governor of Gaul. Now, if you think about where Italy is, up above, most of Italy is where the area of Gaul was. He was a general He had a large army. He was extremely popular there. In fact, he was so popular that the leaders, the senators in Rome, were frightened of him. And so they ordered him to disband his army, to resign his commission. Ancient Roman law said no general dared go south across a little river named the Rubicon with an army. And as he stood before that river, he realized to cross it meant civil war. And if he did, it would mean he was trying to win power by force. And as most know, he crossed that river and war broke out, and he eventually became the emperor of that empire. Farnabius had his own crossroads, and he crossed it successfully. As he was healed, that isn't the end of the story, because Bartimaeus joins the crowd as they move towards Jerusalem. Who can say what sight means better than one who's had sight and then loses it? And so, as that crowd came to Jerusalem, it was Bartimaeus, the blind beggar, who saw for himself Jesus ride into the city, who saw palms waved, who saw cloaks given, who saw the temple and all the other wonders of that city with fresh eyes. There's one other character to think about, and that is someone whose name we do not know. One who had a colt. One who was willing to simply release that animal to the words, "The master has need of it." That's all he needed to hear. And he released the colt that was his. That ride into Jerusalem would have been much different for Jesus if it hadn't been for that colt, because Zechariah had said, "This is the way your king will arise." And Jesus, if he had walked into the city, it would have been much different. "The master has need of it" is something that we too hear. The master has need of our talents. Some hear. Others hear, "The master has need of our skills. The master has need of our ability to relate to others. The master has need of a great many talents and many teachers, many people." Some have heard it. The master needs your ability to teach. The master needs your ability to cook. The master needs your ability to do many different things. Those who are open to that call find great reward. The hard-headed people of our world, though, look at those along the way who freely gave up their clothes without any thought of what might happen to them, who freely gave up time to go out and cut down branches. It all looks foolish to the hard-headed of our world. Have you ever had a time when you just didn't think about the cost of anything? You were carried away by the moment, as the crowds were then. It's a grand feeling to be a part of something like that. And as we are, we often discover incredible blessings. The hard-headed, though, look at things like that and say, "It's all foolishness." And those who look at Christ sometimes wonder at his apparent foolishness, and yet it was the wisdom of God. Years later, that great missionary of the church, Paul, wrote to the church at Rome that they were fools for Christ, Paul and his fellow workers. But first, he did so because Christ for our morning offerings. Share in this celebration. on Sunday, things began to change. Those who opposed him, who wanted his life, were those who had the power to end it. And so on Thursday evening, he met once again with his disciples in a little room. A little room up over a house. And in that room, they celebrated Passover, the time when they remembered that long before Moses had freed the slaves from Egypt. And now, in a few hours, he was prepared to free those people and all the world from the curse of sin and death. And as they shared that meal, he passed some bread amongst them and said, "This is my body, broken for you." And he invited them and us to share as millions and millions have done ever since in this sacrament we call communion. They could not really know, they did not understand what was happening.
Why?
The disciples were still concerned about who was going to be first in that new kingdom that they were sure Jesus was going to establish. He was the one who knew what the cost would be. He invited them as he invites us with those words spoken long ago and in every language since. "This is my blood given for you," as we remember the price he was willing to pay for each one of us.
Oh,
they somehow be a part of our life in the days to come. The people in the crowd threw their garments down on the road, giving him a royal welcome.